Well, as I journey through the land, singing as I go, hope pointing souls to Calvary, to the crimson flow. Many arrows pierce my soul from without within. Oh, but my Lord leads me on, through Him I must win. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face. Oh, there to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Oh, cares all past, I'm home at last, ever to rejoice. Oh, and when in service for my Lord, dark may be the night, but I'll cling more close to Him, He will give me light. Satan's snares may vex my soul, turn my thoughts aside. Oh, but my Lord goes ahead, oh, leads whate'er be tied. For, oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face. Oh, there to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Oh, cares all past, I'm home at last, ever to rejoice. Oh, and when in valleys low I look toward the mountain high, and behold my Savior there leading in the fight, with a tender hand outstretched toward the valley low. Oh, guiding me, I can see as I onward go. Oh, oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face, there to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Oh, cares all past, I'm home at last, ever to rejoice. Oh, and when before me billows rise from the mighty deep, then my Lord directs my bark, He does safely keep. And He leads me gently on through this world below. He's a real friend to me, and oh, I love Him so. Oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face. Oh, there to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. Singing, oh, I want to see Him, look upon His face. There to sing forever of His saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. And there is no satisfaction outside salvation, S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. Oh, there is no satisfaction outside salvation, S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. Well, shout it out loud and clear. Oh, S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. Oh, shout it out loud and clear. S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. Oh, there is no satisfaction outside salvation, S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. Oh, there is no satisfaction outside salvation, S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. Well, shout it out loud and clear. Oh, S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. Oh, shout it out loud and clear. S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. Well, shout it out, oh, loud and clear. Oh, S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. Just shout it out loud and clear. S-A-L-V-A-T-I-O-N. And isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Oh, eyes have seen, ears have heard what's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Oh, isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? And eyes have seen, ears have heard what's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord? Oh, let's sing that again. Oh, isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Oh, eyes have seen, ears have heard what's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus, oh, isn't he wonderful this evening? Well, isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard what's recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Amen. Is he wonderful to you this evening? Amen. Well, I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the days go by. Oh, what a love between my Lord and I keep falling in love with him over and over and over. Oh, I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. I keep falling in love with him over and over and over and over again. He gets sweeter and sweeter as the day. Of ages cleft for me, oh, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flow be of sin the double cure. Save from wrath, my tears forever flow. Could my zeal no longer know? These for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou alone. In my hand no price I bring, simply to my eyes shall close in death. When I rise to worlds unknown and behold thee on thy throne, Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. O Rock of ages, let me hide myself in thee. Oh, let the water
Prayer just to be overflowing this evening. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Oh, just raise your hand and worship him this evening.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Most gracious Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity, Lord, of your grace to bring us here in the house of God again. Lord, thinking where we've come from and where you've brought us from, Lord, we can't help but love you and consider all the great things you've done for us, Father. And Lord, it's an honor and a privilege. Lord, I just pray, Father, tonight, Lord, that you would just take us, move us aside, Father. Sanctify me, Lord, as a vessel, and sanctify those that are here listening. Lord, it's just an honor to be here. I think when I come home, my daughter, she screams, she gets excited because Daddy's home. I wonder, Lord, if that's a feeling in our hearts. Lord, when we get to come into your presence and hear your word, is there an excitement bubbling up inside of us? There is in me, Lord, and I'm thankful for that, Lord, because you had to have put that there. So, Father God, I just pray you would take this evening, take every person, Lord, and, Lord, do your will, Lord, that you've set out to do. Lord, we love you. We commit ourselves to you this night. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you all. Good to see you, musicians. Thank you very much. Well, good evening. Happy to be here? Okay, happy to come to church. Like the little girl that's excited when Daddy comes into their presence, you get excited to hear the Word of God. I'm excited to just go through it with you tonight. And obviously, Brother Chad's gone, Brother Joe's gone, but we have Brother Brian, so we have another tall person near the front, so all is well, nothing to fear. They're over in India, and they're there, so I'm sure we're all praying for them. Heard from Brother Emmanuel, Sister Mimi over in Congo, they're doing well. I'm sure we're praying for them as well. And you know Brother Nathaniel's coming, and Brother Noel's coming, so be praying for them, that God will just anoint them through the week and prepare them so that he can prepare us for whatever he has in store for us. And I also remember there is a youth camp out, so if you haven't signed up for the youth camp out, there's a youth camp out this weekend. Not everybody can sign up. You have to be a youth. So if you're a youth, sign up. And we'll be having that out at the Schwartz, and we're looking to have a good time out there and be praying for that too, if you don't mind. So, announcements make me nervous. So, there, we're done. God bless you. Will you turn in your Bibles to Micah chapter 6? Micah chapter 6. It's kind of like a dreary, rainy day today for a while, and then it got really sunshiny and beautiful, didn't it? Thankful that God could give us that sunshine, because I was freezing. It's pretty cold. Micah chapter 6, verse 6. I wanted to thank the brothers that had prayed for me the other night. I was having spasms in my chest, and I couldn't stand up. And Carrie had asked me, she's like, man, can you preach? I'm like, not like this. So some brothers loved me and prayed for me and went to bed that night. The spasms stopped. I woke up. And it's just a little sore, but no more spasms from that moment. So I appreciate that very, very much. Micah 6:6, say amen if you're there. Amen. Amen. Wherewith shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before the high God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves of a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams or with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of the body, for the sin of my soul? He hath showed thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of thee, but to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with thy God. Just bow our heads for a word one more time. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for your word. Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you take it now, feed your sheep, Lord. You know that I'm insufficient, but Lord, you are more than sufficient. And Lord, this word is what we have need of and our desires to just walk with thee. We love you. We commit this time into your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. So I'd like you to turn in your Bibles also to 1 John chapters 2. And I have a subject that's a daunting subject for me, because the more you look at it, the more you realize It's anybody is insufficient to grab this thought. I'd like to speak this night on a walk with divine love. And you know the old poem, it says if every if the ocean were ink and the every man a scribe and the, every stalk a quill to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry. So When you begin to look at divine love, you find out that you really just need to start in the book of Genesis, and you'll finish up somewhere in Revelations, because it's the entire mystery of God unveiled. The entire story is God's great love story. It's a great letter. It's a great achievement that God's been doing. And the more I begin to look at this divine love and the nature of God and the desire to walk with Him, I find out that it's just so expansive. It's just never ending. And I had wanted to leave the thought from where I had did a little devotion at the camp, where I had titled a thought, Divine Love's Journey. And there I was kind of speaking from some things that I had heard from Christ, the Mystery of God Revealed. And in that, I realized this isn't just a journey to divine love, it's a journey with divine love. Divine love's a person. It's Jesus Christ. And as I began to think on this a little bit more, I kind of wanted to take a step three. I'm not much of a part preacher. I'm not one part, two part, three part, but this is kind of like a third part for me, because I'm continuing with the same inspiration that I drew from those little devotions, and I hope that's okay. I'd just like to look at some things together and almost have a little Bible study. So there's a lot of scriptures tonight, and there's a lot of quotes, but we'll just see what the Lord has in store. If you have 1 John 2, he that saith he is in the light and hateth his brother is in darkness even until now. He that loveth his brother abideth in the light, and there is none occasion of stumbling in him. But he that hateth his brother is in darkness and walketh in darkness and knoweth not whither he goeth, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. And so the reality of this walking with, we always talk, we are very well versed in walking in the light as he is in the light. Then you shall have fellowship one with another, and then the blood of Jesus Christ shall cleanse you all your sins. But do you realize that this light is leading us to the great light, and that great light is divine love? Because through divine love, God has it has expressed all of his attributes. But the whole thing is God's great mystery secret of love. The whole thing. And so along the way, Brother Wesley had asked me the question, I'll bring you up to date if you didn't know why I'm starting down this way, because in the devotions I was asked a question from Brother Wesley when we were flying back from Idaho. And he said, you know, brother, what great revelation do you believe we'll all come to in this rapture? And I stopped for a second and I began to think, divine love. Because Brother Branham said, and he said, there, remember in the Beyond the Curtain of Time, he said, I heard a voice that spoke to me in the room, and it said, this is what you preached was the Holy Ghost. This is perfect love, and nothing can enter here without it. And it's just as he said it, I remembered the quote, and I said, it's got to be divine love. Because we know the rapture is a revelation, and the revelation, Brother Branham said, is faith. And faith works by love. So this great rapture, and And Brother Branham calls the rapture the showdown. And I had stumbled across the life story of Brother Branham. And Brother Branham, the portion where he fell in love with Hope, and he wanted to ask Hope to marry him. You all know this story. And he didn't have the nerve to ask her, so he wrote a letter. And he wrote the letter, and he addressed the letter to Hope. And he put it in the mailbox, and he was so nervous, you know, waiting, couldn't sleep that night. He got there the next day, and he was waiting to see what would she say. And he said he couldn't think straight, you know, he's waiting to see, and she never responded. Said they went to church, and they were in church, and he said, I didn't hear a word that minister said. I didn't know a thing. I was just sitting there in anticipation. What was she going to say? What was going to be the reaction? What was going to be it? And he said, I sat there in suspense, and it was a real showdown for me. What would she say? And, you know, me, I'm odd. And I get to looking at things, I said, isn't it interesting? The very messenger to the age that brought a message was actually in his own life expressing the great purpose and desire that God had. God's great love secret, mystery secret, the Bible. God's great mystery secret of love, he wrote a letter. And he's been in suspense, but he's been suspenseful, waiting for the showdown, what will be her answer. And there's so many aspects of it that is so interesting, because Christ in us is the hope of all glory. It is not just that we would know God or know about God. It was that God would be known through us. God, like Brother Bam said, he said, you love your wife so much, you get to the point you just feel like you just want to hug her and just pull her on inside of you, and you'd really be warm. You remember that? And so it was, you think about God and his nature and what he really wants. He didn't want just a people that knew about him. He wanted a people that he could express himself through. He really wanted that. That was his great desire. And he realized that only happens with the individual that can come into an intimacy with him. And, you know, I was thinking, you know, me and my wife, we have a relationship here with you all here at the church, and you know us. We have a public view. You know us a certain way. But there's a private life to me and Carrie that none of you know anything about. But you know a lot about us, but there's something you know nothing about. And we come to church and we serve God as a group and as a people, but you realize there is a relationship that I have with God that I can't even fully express with you all. There's a private life with me, and there's a private life with you, and that's what God always wanted, is that private life with you. Just you and him, just really be close, really be cozy then, you know? And they get to thinking about that was the third pole. There was the outer court, there was the great big tent, and then there's the little room. And he said, I'll meet you in there, in that little room. You'll be hidden away, tucked away in the secret of my dwelling. And you begin to look at this over and over and over, and I realized that's what I've always wanted. We enjoy coming to church. We enjoy fellowshipping. We enjoy the word together. But realistically, it's all bringing me to a point where I'm just walking with him alone. There's only enough, Brother Bram said, there's only enough room on that road for two, you and him. And so we enjoy it, we love it, but we realize God's great mystery secret was a love affair between you and God. And it's very intimate, and it's very secret, and it's very a private life. And that's what he's always wanted, and that's what I believe he's achieving in his bride. And I believe that the bride of Jesus Christ comes to that revelation that she's walking in divine love with divine love himself. It's a person. I'm just walking with him. And so I'd like to just take this from some scriptures and some quotes. I hope it's okay with you tonight. It's a little different for me because I'm spending so much time looking at it. He says, now the people in this day, they lie, they cheat, they steal. You almost have to get a bond of security to borrow $5 from somebody. It's, you know, the Bible speaks of that, that there would be no love in the last days, but just amongst the elect people. That's right. The scripture speaks of that, that the husband would be against the wife and the wife would be against the husband and children against their parents. Just among the elect of the Lord, there will be love left. So if there's one characteristic, if there's one identification that I can say that I am an elect of God or you are the elect of God, it will be divine love. It will be love. I may not know all the doctrines. I know I don't know all the doctrines. I may not have a great depth like you would have a great depth. But may God, by his grace, give me the attribute of his life so much so that I can love even my enemies. Because sometimes I think we get caught up. We get going too fast. We get to thinking, well, God showed me this, and I know I'm his elect, and he brought me here, and he brought me there. But do you realize that it was for the purpose of divine love to come back into view in this earth? You are the vessel that he was going to express to this earth divine love. And it won't be found anywhere else except the elect. It can't. He said it wouldn't. He said, because, you remember the prophecy, because thou hast chosen the narrow path, the harder way, thou hast walked in thine own choosing. Thou hast picked the correct and the precise decision, and it is my way. Because of this momentous decision, a huge portion of heaven awaits thee. With what a glorious decision thou hast made. This in itself is that which will give and make to come to pass a tremendous victory in love divine. Because he made his choice to walk with the word and be rejected by this entire generation and all his friends to stay faithful to God. And because he made his choice, and we've seen that wave sheaf expressed before us. Now I can make mine to where I can not only walk with divine love, I can express divine love. But it is made up of two parts. And this is from what I see, is this divine love is both sacrificial and it's elective. You make your own choice. I could love my wife, Carrie. She could... But unless I can't force her to love me, she's got to love me. She's got to make her own choice. If I force this decision, I have totally ruined love being expressed. And so many times, sometimes we sometimes maybe we witness or ministers would minister in such a way like almost by force, I can mold you into the bride. You can't do that because you, as soon as you try that, you've totally threw out the mystery plan of God. God was speaking his word, his love secrets, making love to his church, and there's a bride that will respond in such a way that she'll sacrificially give her life away, give her desire away, give her will away, say, it's not my will, it's thy will be done, and I love you so much, it's my honor to do it. You know, I don't believe, I know I don't preach so that you'll tell me I'm a good preacher. I don't do that. I preach because I love God. I preach because I love you, and I love his word, and I believe it's the truth. That's why I preach. And you, I believe you serve God not because you want to be thought well of everybody here. I believe you serve God because you love God. You know, God wants to be loved. Not, you can't force this. It's got to be his expression. It's got to be something you're willing to give. You want to give it. You see what I'm saying? Hope this is you understand what I'm saying. Okay. And so Jesus said in John 13:34, and you all know these things. These are very basic. But sometimes we fly too fast over these basics. By this shall all men know you are my disciples, if you have love one for the other. That's a very common Bible scripture that all of us have learned from a very young age. But put it into action. Put it into action. Matthew 5, ye have heard, and it has been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. But I say unto you, love your enemies, and bless them that curse you, and do good to them that hate you, and pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be the children of your Father which is in heaven. For he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sendeth rain on the just and the unjust. For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? Do not even the publicans the same? And if you salute your brethren only, what do you more than others? Do not even the publicans so? But be ye perfect as your Father which is in heaven is perfect. It's easy to love people that love you. But do you love those that hate you? Can you do good to those that don't like you? It's not easy. But if the love of God is there and you're walking with divine love, you will express that. And if you can't express that, then we have to ask questions. We can't go so fast that we realize, uh-oh, I'm not even expressing the evidence of his life being there. I can quote a quote, I can recite a scripture verse or something along the lines, but I can't express what he said would be the evidence of the bride, the ability to love the unlovely, the ability to express love to those that aren't deserving of it. You see what I'm saying? I know it's common and I know it's simple, but it's got to be there. It is the identifying mark of the bride of Jesus Christ, the ability to love when no one else loves you back. You know what I'm saying? That's just the reality of it. In a husband and wife's relationship, there's times that I'm sure Carrie doesn't like me, but she has to love me. It's just the reality of it. I can do some really boneheaded things at times. It's just the reality, but she loves me. And I remember years ago, there was a poll put out, and it was everybody over that married 50 years, and they said, what was the common thing? And they said that the most common thing was their love for the other person hid their annoyances, or it blinded them to the things they didn't exactly, that annoyed them. You see what I'm saying? Like, love is blinding. There's a blinding effect to love. There really is. When you love someone, you can look past their mistakes. Brother Branham says, if you really love that brother, if he does bad to you, you won't even think about it. You'll still say nice things about him. You'll still love him. You'll still treat him nice, even if he doesn't treat you nice. See, we're not trying to measure up one with another. We're not saying, well, he said it. If that one does it, it has nothing to do with it. We're measuring up with God himself. Right. Be ye perfect as God is perfect, and God is love. And the ability to love the ones that don't love you. Because I find sometimes, so many times, we get so busy and so excited about maybe doctrinal depths and truths that we see and mysteries that are unveiled, and we fly right over the basic principles and identifying marks of the bride of Jesus Christ. She loves. She loves. She always loves. She does good. She's kind. She's gentle. She walks with a merciful walk. You see what I read there? God is looking for those that do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with him. He's not going to have an arrogant, prideful individual that walks with him. It's not going to happen. He's not going to use that. That's not the ones that are going to be worthy to walk with him. And I just want to walk with him. You want to walk with him? I mean, am I the only one? I was like, Lord, I guess just rip me to shreds if you got to, because I want to. I got to walk with you. I enjoy spending time with you all. I enjoy coming to church. I enjoy being a part of every service and every minister that preaches. But I just want to walk with him. I really do. I don't want to say amen here, and then I can't walk with him through the week because I'm so angry and upset about situations and individuals and things they've done and things they've said. It'll mess you up. It will really mess you up. And so as we continue on, you know, the power of love, we all know that it is so powerful. Brother Bam says it's the greatest force on earth, but we so often don't use it. You know, it was the love of God that conquered you, right? It was that all-sufficient love of God that conquered you that we just sometimes maybe forget about. We don't remember it as often as we should. I mean, think where you were. And think where you'd be if God had not come your way. You should stop and think that through. Because when I do, it humbly drops my head and say, Lord, I would have destroyed myself over and over again if your love that saw me in my worst condition did not come to me, where would I be? You know, have we forgotten those things? Do we take the time to remember that the love of God saw you in the worst state that you were ever in and came to you? Now, if the love of God, that divine love, did that, will you do that when you find somebody in their worst state? Can you? Because if God's there, won't he? Isn't the evidence of the believer is Christ's own life manifesting in you? It has to. This is the elements and the attributes of a Christian. And so he says, now, doctors can help people. I believe that God heals through medicine. I believe that God heals through surgery. I believe that God heals through understanding. And God heals through love. Just a little love will go a long way. Let somebody be all upset and just show them how much you care about them. See, God heals by love. God heals by prayer. God heals by miracles. God heals by his word. Amen? So Josh and the brothers that prayed for me, you know, I believe God answered their prayer, but maybe it was just the expression of divine love that brought forth the healing in my life. Two people or three people that would recognize, uh-oh, this boy's in trouble. This guy's in trouble. Let me pray with him, you know? So many times we just don't do that. We're a body of believers. We love each other, and that's the thing. That's the one thing. Regardless if I can't preach a good sermon, I know I'm amongst a people that will love me and suffer with me. They suffer because this is a people of divine love. They know how to suffer long with individuals, right? We suffer with one another. We're a family. We're a part of the bride of Jesus Christ. We're not quick to condemn an individual. We're quick to bring him back into the fold if it's possible. That's what we do. That's who we are. 1 John 4:7. 1 John 4:7. Beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested the love of God towards us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us. And he sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God dwelleth in us, and his love is perfected in us. Hereby know we that we dwell in him, and he in us, because he hath given us his Spirit. And you think about that God commended his love towards us, and while we were yet sinners. And I've told you my testimony, and I know, and I'll stand on the day of judgment, God came to me when I was in a bar and ran me out of that place. I was not in a good condition. I was not an upstanding citizen at the moment, but he in his love told me to get out of there. Why would he do that? I mean, he's a holy God. How does a holy God? Because he had an attribute in there, an attribute that was in the wrong place that needed to get out of there, and he came and ran me out of there. And I know he did. So this is an interesting thing. If God would go to such lengths to redeem me and bring me out, what lengths will you do to go redeem someone else? Like, do we just cast people aside? You know, Brother Wesley and I were in the, when we were flying through the airports, I told Brother Wesley, I said, you know what? Think of how honored and privileged of a people we are. We know where we came from, and we know where we are going. And all these people with their pink hair, blue hair, makeup, men with skirts on, and I mean, just crazy nonsense. They've totally lost their mind. They totally lost their identity. They don't know where they came from. They don't know where they're going. And here we are, two simple men just walking through an airport saying, we know where we came from. I came from God, and I'm going back to God. I came from divine love, and I'm coming back to divine love. This is where I came from, and this is where I'm going. I have a true identification. He sent his word in this day, and it called me out, and it called me up into a perfect identification. That cloud, when it came down, it wasn't just a cloud coming saying that he has come to bring forth the revelation of his word. No, Brother Branham was caught up into that cloud. And when he was caught up into that cloud, he saw himself in his own place in the mystery of God. And he was a part of that unveiling. And I was too. I've been caught up. And I'm being caught up. And it's just happening. And I'm walking into divine love. We all started walking. Every one of us, we started walking. God came your way. He brought forth a light to you. You came out of dead denomination. You came to a church. You got baptized. You started dressing different, eating different, talking different, listening to different things, acting different. Everything started changing with you, right? And you did good. You did wonderful until that brother said something to you. Until that sister just really just irritated you something fierce. And then you wonder, well, I don't know. No. It's just part of the perfecting hand of God in your life to correct you, to mold you, to shape you, to start cutting away all the things that can't be there. And the main thing of it is you. You've got to get cut away. Like Michelangelo, when he saw the stone, he didn't add to the big masterpiece, you know, the stone. He had to cut a ton away. He just keep cutting, keep cutting, keep coming until the image that he had in his mind came into view. And God brought you in as an unshaped stone and began to cut you by his word, cut you by experiences, cut you by people that said things about you that weren't quite the nicest things. But he's cutting you. Amen. He's cutting away everything that's there to unveil his great masterpiece, and that is divine love. It's you and it's me, and it has to come into view again. He said it was going to come into view. So we can't get too upset when things around us start to get a little bit strange, a little bit weird, a little bit difficult. Difficulties in the church, difficulties amongst people, difficulties in the economy, difficulties all around us, you know, almost like enemies surrounding us and all over the place, you know. But God kind of provided a place for us, a hiding place for us, you know, right in the rock, you know. It just makes perfect sense. This is what God is doing. And so I'm so glad that we have not lost our minds. If anything, we are losing this natural mind, and I'm getting the mind of Christ that's bringing back into view what this was all about. God, in his mercy, had called me from a child. I didn't realize who I'd been walking with all these years. You didn't realize who you were walking with. But God, in his mercy, won't even let you stay comfortable with a church life. He won't let you. He won't let you stay comfortable with just being a part of the right group. He won't let you. Remember, there's the outer court, inner court, and the Holy of Holies. There's three stages to this journey to perfection. There has to be. There has to be a step where you come from out of the world, you're baptized, you come into the fellowship, you come into the church, but realizing I'm still going in a direction behind the veil to where it's just me and him. Then it does not matter what anybody does. It doesn't matter how anybody acts. It doesn't matter how anybody talks to you. It does not matter. You're shut in. There's nobody else in there. It's just you and God. You know, God will do that sometimes. God will get you so uncomfortable in your life at times that really you think that maybe you're pulling away, you're falling away, you're getting cold. No, God is just not allowing you to stay comfortable in that position. He's pulling you into his presence. And you didn't even realize that's what he's doing. He won't let you stay right there. I've got to pull you a little bit closer. Remember, this is a great love affair and a great mystery of love. God looking for the individual. Brother Bam said, making love to his church. So, and I sometimes I find it interesting because I have not arrived. Has anybody yet arrived to perfect divine love? Praise God, I'm a part of a group that's still in perfection. None of us have yet arrived. We can say, hey, we're here, we're ready, we've done it, we've accomplished it, we overcome every obstacle that comes our way. No, no, no. We treat everybody kind at all times. No, we don't suffer along with everybody. Not exactly. But I love this attitude about something that I saw in Paul. You know, Paul, having the great mystery understanding of God, he never had the attitude that he had arrived. He never got into a place that he said, I've got it figured out. I can hold my head up and my nose up a little higher than everybody because I know what's going on and nobody else does. You know, Paul, the Apostle Paul, didn't act like that. No matter how much of an understanding and revelation he had, he still had a humble attitude saying, I haven't yet apprehended, but I'm pressing to apprehend the one that I've been apprehended by. He hadn't yet fully grasped divine love, perfect faith, but he was still in pursuit of it. And I can say, are you still in pursuit of it? I haven't yet fully grasped it. I've experienced it. I've seen it in my life. I've seen what God's done for me. And yet it does something to me to keep pressing, to keep going, to keep trying to apprehend that divine love that has apprehended me. You remember that little story a couple years ago I preached about that that bird that was on my front porch, the pterodactyl birdie? He was fearless. He was just a fearless bird, but he was, I think, conquered by love. And he was conquering everything that came in his path by love because he loved these two little baby birds and it put an attitude in him. He was not afraid of anything. And did not the Bible say perfect faith casts out all fear? And perfect faith casts out all fear, then what do we have to be afraid of? Let the economy collapse. Let politics go wild. Let everything fall apart. What does it matter? We have a perfect love and a perfect faith in God. God is in control. What do we have to worry about? You realize how little you have to worry about? Put it in the scope of the mightiness of God. You have nothing to worry about. Don't be afraid. Don't be concerned. There's nothing to be concerned about if your faith is in God. If your faith's in God, there's nothing to be concerned about. People can go lose their minds on the economy. You're like, I'm doing fine. My father owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. He'll take care of me. One of the things that I realized in the life of Brother Branham, it always stumbled me in the beginning there because I said, how could I ever come to this? How can I do this? And you know the scripture, or you know the quote when Brother Branham says, even if he sends me to hell, I will love him there. If there is such a thing as love there, I'll love him there. That always stumbled me. I'm like, I have not come to that yet. I struggled with that for the first couple years. And then do you remember the quote when Brother Branham says, a man said, you are a false prophet. He said, let's just go with you for a second. Let's say that I am a false prophet. Let's say you're right. He said, you know, I wouldn't want to change my position if that's his will. He said, I wouldn't want to change my position. He said, I love him so much, I just want to do his will. He said that in 1965. You see where he had come to in his ministry. It was no longer, I'm serving God for blessings. I'm serving God to get rewards. I'm serving God to, you know, at that day of judgment or the day of rewards, there's going to be, hey, look at what this one did. He wasn't doing it for that anymore. You know, I don't believe a minister preaches for accolades. A minister preaches because he loves God. You serve God because you love God, not because you're looking for rewards or a handout at that day. I don't believe it's like that. I believe it just comes to the point you just love God. He's worthy to be loved. His character, his nature is so amazing. It's so mighty. It's so powerful. It's so shocking. You just want to serve him. Then if that is the reality and that's the view in which you live your life, does it really matter what anybody else does that would get you upset? No, because you're serving God because you love God. You don't serve God to see if this one will react a certain way, this one will view you a certain way. You don't do it for that. It's a private life. It's a secret life with him. And so when you begin to realize, he said, faith without works is dead. And anything you do that isn't motivated by love, he's going to have people come to him on the day and they say, hey, we gave our bodies to be burned. Did you do it by divine love? No. Hey, we gave all of our money to the poor. Did you do it with love? No. This is going to be an interesting day on that day. Because then it's going to come into view, why did you do everything that you did? Why did you come to church? Why did you dress the way you did? Why did you do this? Why did you do that? Why are you doing this? Why did you come tonight? Why did you come? Did you come because, well, they'll call me if I didn't. Them deacons, you got to watch out for them. They're real police officers. Huh? I did it because, well, you know, the family came. I better come. Well, you know, I got to be looking like a good dad. I got to bring the boys. No, you come because you love God. I hope you come to hear the word of God because you just love God. And you say, Lord, I got to find my bad spots. I got to find out where I'm falling short so I can repent and say, I'm sorry. Forgive me, God. Help me to stand up and keep going. Let me walk with love. You know? So I'd like to read that because it's such a shocking thought. A man said to me the other day, I think you're a fine man, Brother Branham, but I believe you're sincerely wrong and you're out of the will. Do you know that you'll be condemned in the end? And I said, look, I want to tell you something. I'm going to say that you are right, just to say for the sake of the argument. If I am wrong, which I don't believe I am, but if I was wrong and I knowed right now that I was going to live to be 100 years old and he was going to condemn me at the end of the road and tell me, you don't deserve to come into my heaven, William Branham. Get out into outer darkness. You know what? I would serve him every day of my life until I went anyhow. For I have received so much of his unmerited blessings, and he is more than life to me. He's everything. All that I am, all that I would ever hope to be, I have derived from his grace and from his mercy. I was a wretched, miserable, poor, blind, but the grace of God healed me, and I'm strong and healthy. And by his grace, God, I have good eyesight. I can eat and I can drink. He never promised to supply my wants, but my needs. And if I am cast away at that day, I cannot see where I would be. But if I knew that I was wrong and God had chose me to be wrong, I would want to stay wrong. And because that I want to do his will, I love him till I want his will to be done. Now, that's a big statement, but I hope you get it in the way and in the spirit in which it's said. See, I want to do his will. I ask him sometimes for things, and he shakes his head. No, I just rejoice just as much about that as when he says yes, because we always ought to ask, thy will be done. His no's are just as good. That's his will. That's right. It's a whole lot better than this yeses if it's not. That's when you really love him. Whoa. When his no's are as good as his yeses, because you know you're in his will. Even if he desires me to be a vessel of destruction, I won't change my position. I want his will. This, to me, is a different kind of a love. That's a different kind of a love. This is a love that is not serving God for any reward or any satisfaction. It is a love that truly just wants whatever he wants. This is a love that I believe we are coming to. I honestly believe with all my heart. I look where I've come from, and I'm still not where, I'm not there yet, and I want to be there. See, he knows the desire of my heart. I want to get to the point where I can say, Lord, if it's a yes, wonderful. If it's a no, wonderful. Lord, it does not matter anymore at all. Whatever you want, Lord, I'm ready to do it. That's where we want to be. That's a bride that finds her identity only in her husband, only in her mate. His will is my desire. That's it. And so that's a big statement. But you know, when Brother Branham said about Moses, he said, it always stumbled me, Moses, how he could say, Lord, blot my name out of your book, but don't forsake your people, for they'll say of you, you could bring them out, but not take them in. He said, for your sake, for your name's sake, don't do it. He said, I always wondered, how could he say that? He said, until I realized it was Christ in Moses saying that. And then you get to looking at Brother Branham and say, how can a man say that? But then you realize it's Christ in Brother Branham saying that. And then you wonder, I say, in this flesh, I can't say that. But Christ in me can say that. I, this flesh, can't do it. But he in me can do it. Because that's his will and I want his will. So God, get me there. Just keep breaking me down. Keep cutting me to shreds. Keep cutting away everything that's not like that until it comes into view. 1 John 3:11. For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning. You want to know what the message is? That you should love one another. Not as Cain, who was of the wicked one, and slew his brother. And wherefore slew he him? Because his own works were evil, and his brother's righteous. He was jealous. Marvel not, my brethren, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death unto life, because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Whosoever hateth his brother is a murderer, and ye know that no murderer hath eternal life abiding in him. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. Charity suffers long. This is the evidence of the elect. This is the evidence of the Holy Spirit. A love for the brethren, a love for one another, no matter what they do, no matter how they act, no matter what they say, you still love them. I'll read you this poem, Brother Branham quoting. If the ocean were all ink, and the skies was a parchment, and every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade to write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry. Or could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky? Ever since by faith I saw that stream, thy flowing wound supplied, redeeming love has been my theme, and it shall be till I die. And I think the one thing that the universal church of God is need of tonight is love. We do not need the things that we think we do. All these other things, emotions, gifts, they're all wonderful. And to God we give praise. But if those gifts are not governed by love, then they are not effective. Love should govern our home. Love is the greatest force that has ever been put in the power of man. A home that is not disciplined by love is not much of a home. If a husband and wife doesn't solemnly love each other, they cannot trust each other. That's why I think that instead of resting our faith on some emotion, which is all right, or some gift, which is all right, like shouting or speaking in tongues and all these other things that we take in as evidence of the Holy Spirit, those things are all right. But if we would come back to the principle, love first, and then those other things, I think our church will progress a lot better if we put God first, and God is love. Put God first, love. The very first evidence of the Holy Spirit. You okay? I told you I got lots of quotes. Like, you realize when you start to look into divine love, just how big the subject is. It's the whole Bible. It goes everywhere. Now, in the Thyatiran church age, he says, I know your love, service, faith, and patience. You will note that love is placed between works and service. And this is the right place for it, because without love, our works are not accepted before God, and neither is our service. Paul speaking to the Corinthians, without love, I am nothing, and whatever I do is without profit unless it is done by love. That love in our hearts was God's love for his own, Jesus said. By this shall all men that know you are my disciples, when you have love one for the other. You realize everything you do, if it wasn't done in love, will not be accounted to you. Everything you do. You go to church faithfully, but if you did not go because you love God, it won't be done, it won't be accounted to you. Every person you witness to, if you didn't do it for divine love, you just did it to beat your chest and tell somebody how much more you know about something than they do. If you preach a sermon just to show how much you know about the message, it will mean nothing. Everything. If it's not done in love, it's a waste of time and energy. That's a big thought to consider. We do so much, but sometimes we don't realize why we do what we do, or ask the question, why am I doing this? Why do I come to church? Why do I serve God? Why do I bear with one another? Because I love God. He says, now, I want to give a warning here. It says concerning the last days, that because the abounding of iniquity, the love of many will wax cold in this last age, Laodicean. Self-love, or love for material things, will take the place of the true love of God. We need to guard against this power of sin in the last days. So many are getting hard because they haven't realized the effects of this last day spirit. It is time to draw nigh to God and let him fill our lives with his love, or we will feel the coldness of this last day church and reject the truth of God, which alone is able to help us. This is something he's warning the church. You must guard against it. It's a powerful spirit trying to rob from you the love of God, but make you feel comfortable because you know doctrinal truths and you go to the right church. But that's not your hiding place. No, that's not. Divine love. is Sovereign Grace expressed. Now we are faced in this day, as it prophesied, that brotherly love would become a very strange thing among people. It is to my humble belief that it is the greatest of all the gifts there is in the Bible. If the Lord Jesus would stand on the platform tonight and look me straight in the face and say, I'm going to give you your choice. You can be a great person, a great minister, or I'll give you the gift of preaching the gospel. I'll give you the gift of teaching the word. I'll give you the gift of divine healing. I'll give you the gift of prophecy. I will make you a prophet or any of those fine gifts of faith. I'll give you all those gifts in the Bible. I'll give you every one of them. But then I will withhold love from you. Or either I'll give you love and withhold all the gifts from you. I'd say, Lord, take all those gifts and let me have love. See, for no matter how many gifts we got, they would never do us any good except the love of God is there motivating each gift. We must have love. If you sing a song for special and you do it to show your voice, and you didn't do it because you love God, it didn't do anything. Tinkling cymbal, sound of brass. You know this is true. Anybody that has a gift, if it's not motivated by love, it's a waste of time. It's a true gift. And the gift will operate, but it will not be accounted to you for anything in that day because it wasn't done by love. It's an amazing thought. Really amazing. I believe the reason that we don't have a desperation is because we lack love. God, the love of God, I think that the love of God causes a desperation. If God is in you and the token is inside of you and you see the conditions of the times and you see people wading into sin the way they are, it will throw you into a desperation if the love of God's there. Mark all those that sigh and cry for the abominations done in the land, Brother Branham said. Here's the evidence of the Holy Spirit. How many of us do? See, are we guarding ourselves against the coldness of the spirit of this day? The iniquity that abounds in the land. We have to. The prophet of God warned us. I'm just saying what he said. Do you remember the story Brother Branham tells about the girl, the lady he had went into a restaurant there, and she was an older lady with the hair, and she was purple and pink and drinking some whiskey and stuff like that, and he began to condemn her in his heart. Just think, Lord, just stand back and just wipe the whole thing clean. Just eradicate the whole thing. And Brother Branham says that God took him behind the door and a vision came up before him. And you all know the vision, but I'd like to read it if this is okay, because it's such a striking thought that God wanted his prophet to see. And I think there's a reason we should constantly look at this, because when Brother Branham could see the condition that his own sins would have brought him into if there wasn't the grace of God standing there in the gap protecting him, it stopped him in his tracks and caused him to repent for what he and how he was viewing everybody around him in this world. And when you get a haughty type of an attitude and looking at the people of this world with an arrogancy and a just wipe them off the face of the earth, I'm telling you, that's not the love of God. That's not the love of God. That's not the nature and spirit of God inside of you expressing that. It's just not. But you lack a certain revelation of the love of God. He said, I began to see something move in front of me. It was like a little whirl. It started going around and around. I watched it, and the world was turning around and around, and I watched it. And where it was spraying something off, I looked, and it was a spray of red, crimson blood, across around the world. It just kept whirling around and around like a comet. And it was a whirling around like this, and I looked at that whirl, and just above it, I saw Jesus in the vision. He was looking down, and I seen myself standing here on earth doing the things that I should not do. And every time I sinned, God would have killed me, because the day you eat thereof, that day you die. And God's holiness and justice required it, and you have to die. And then I looked there, and I kept rubbing my eyes, and I never went to sleep. It was a vision. I'm sure it was a vision. I kept watching, and as I stood by the door, I saw my own sins come up. And every time they would start to hit the throne, his blood would act like a bumper on a car. And it caught it, and I'd see it shake, and the blood would run down his face. And I see him raise up his hand and say, Father, forgive him. He doesn't know what he's doing. I seen myself do something else. It shook him again. God would have killed me right then, but his blood was catching me. It was holding my sins. I thought, oh, God, did I do that? Surely it wasn't me, but it was. Then I went walking like this, and I was going through the room, and I walked up close to him, and I seen the book laying there. and it had my name on it and all kinds of black letters wrote across it. And I said, Lord, I'm sorry. I did this. Did my sins cause you to do that? Did I spin your blood around the world? Did I do it, Lord? Lord, I'm so sorry for that. He reached out and said, and I said, Lord, forgive me. I didn't mean to. By your grace, I'll be a better boy, and you help me. He took his hand and patted my side, took his finger, and he wrote pardoned on the book. He threw it behind him into the sea of forgetfulness. I watched it for a little bit, and he said, now, I forgave you, but you want to condemn her. See? Said, you're forgiven, but what about her? You want to blow her up. You didn't want her to live. I thought, oh God, forgive me. I didn't mean to think like that. I didn't mean to do that. I didn't want that. You're forgiven. You feel all right, but what about her? She needs it too. Well, I thought, God, how did you've called and or you haven't called. It's my business to speak to everyone. So when the vision left me, I walked over to her and I said, how do you do, lady? And the two of them were in the restroom. She was sitting there hiccuping, you know, laughing. The bottle of whiskey was there on the table, or beer, or alcohol was sitting there, been drinking. I walked up and I said, how do you do? She said, hello. I said, can I sit down? She said, oh, I got company. I said, I didn't mean it like that, sister. She looked at me when I called her sister. She said, what do you want? I said, could I sit down for a minute? She said, help yourself. I sat down. I told her what had happened. She said, what's your name? I said, Branham. She said, you're the man down here in this arena. I said, yes, ma'am. She said, I've been wanting to come down there. She said, Mr. Branham, I was raised in a Christian home. I got two young girls that's Christians. But certain things happened, and so, and she got on the wrong path, and she started. I said, but sister, I don't care. The blood is still around you, and the world is covered over with it. If it didn't, God would have killed us, every one of us, and the blood... When that blood moved, look out for judgment. But now, if you die without that blood, you'll go to beyond a place, and there's nothing that'll act for you. Today, the blood acts in your stead. I said, lady, sure, the blood has still got you covered, as long as you've got breath in your body, and the blood has got you covered. But someday, when the breath leaves here, your soul goes out, you'll be beyond the blood, and there's nothing but judgment. While you still have a chance for pardon, and I took her by the hand. She started crying. Mr. Branham, I'm drinking. I said, that don't hurt. Something another has warned me to come tell you. I said, God, before the foundation of the world, called you. Sister, you're doing wrong, and you're only making it worse. She said, do you think he will have me? I said, absolutely he'll have you. There on her knees, she got down in the middle of the floor, and we had an old-fashioned prayer meeting. The police took off his hat, and he bowed a knee. There we had prayer meeting in that place. Why? God is sovereign. You think of that story in light of it, and you've got to realize and you've got to admit that we have been in the same situation dozens of times. We have personally come up with the same attitude towards people in this world. We've looked at it, we've thought it, we've said it. Lord, just wipe it off. But you know what? God had to give him a revelation right at that time of his own sin, his own sinful condition, and the pardoning of grace in his own life for him to be able to extend a love like that to this woman. And you begin to forget what God's done for you. I promise you, you cannot extend love to anybody else because you have forgotten the great love that God had for you. And you just can't do it. You can't have patience. You can't have long-suffering. You can't have gentleness, meekness, kindness for anybody because you are forgetting your own personal revelation of when God rescued you. It's just not possible. And then you get an arrogancy about you, and then it's downhill from there. And so I don't want that to happen for me. I certainly don't. God help us all to just have that attitude of divine love no matter who we come in contact. While yet they got breath in their body, you never know. They may be closer than you think. They may not be bright. That's okay. But they may not reject truth when you come and give it to them. You may be the only opportunity they have to find pardoning grace of some sort in this life. And there's a purpose for it. And there's a reason for it. And I think we should take our lives very seriously. Where we go, what we do, and who we come in contact with from a day-to-day basis. You mind turning your Bibles to 1 Corinthians 13? Very familiar. Very, very familiar. It's okay tonight. It's a little bit slow, but we're just taking it one word at a time. Though I speak with tongues of men and angels, and I have not charity, I become a sounding brass, tinkling cymbal. Though I have the gift of prophecy, and I understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains, and have not charity, I am nothing. I just jumped in my mind. I might say this. Sometimes you can have faith for something. Maybe someone would lay hands on somebody and they get healed. I don't know if always you should be telling everybody about that. Maybe that's between you and God. Maybe that's just for God's glory in that individual's. Because sometimes you see a boasting about the things of God amongst people, even amongst believers sometimes, where they want to express, oh, God showed me this, or I know this about God, or he used me to do this, and I did this. And you begin to wonder, why are you saying those things? You know, God used me to do this in a person's life, or God used me to do this. Why you got to tell everybody? It was for God's glory, right? You see what I'm saying? If it wasn't done in love, even that won't matter. It's very interesting. Though I have all faith, have not charity, means nothing. Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. Charity suffers long, it's kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not of itself, it's not puffed up. Doth not behave itself unseemly, and it doesn't seek its own. It's not easily provoked, and it thinketh no evil. It rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. It beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never faileth. That right there, you should put on your refrigerator. Love never will fail. You can never express love and ever expect it to fail. It can't. Either if that fails, God fails, because God is love. You ever get in a situation where you say, I know I need to express love here, but I really want to tell them off. And you express love, I promise you, it'll work. It can't fail. It just can't fail. But whether there be prophecies, they'll fail. Whether there's tongues, they shall cease. And whether there be knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away with. And I will remind you, Brother Branham said, and we have today, by God's grace, the perfect interpretation of the word of God with divine vindication. So that which is perfect has come. Divine love is available. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. For though we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face, now I know in part, but then I shall know even as I am known. I came from divine love, and I'm going back to divine love. This capstone, this rapture. 1 John, if you turn to it, 1 John 4, 16. And musicians, will you come? 1 John 4, 16. And we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love. And he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. What do you think he's referring to? What kind of nature? What kind of attitude? Or how are we going to have such boldness in that day? There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out all fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. Now turn in your Bibles to Psalms 27. Perfect love casts out all fear. The Lord is the light, is my light, and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came up upon me to eat my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, this one thing I will be confident. One thing I desired of the Lord that I seek after, that I might dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion, and in the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me on a rock. This great rock of the redeeming divine love of God that not only came to redeem you, but it came to bring you back into your rightful condition as an individual. In the last part of that, John, it says, we love him because he first loved us. If a man say, I love God, and he hateth his brother, he is a liar. And he that loveth not his brother, whom he can see, how can he love God whom he cannot see? And this is the commandment that we have from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. You cannot love God if you cannot love your brother. And I don't care how wicked he is. It does not matter. What he does, how he acts, does not dictate whether or not you love him. You love him no matter what. That's what we do. And I'll tell you, if I ever get, let's say I go wild, I sure hope there's some brothers and sisters that love me enough that wouldn't condemn me and say, well, forget about him. I hope there's people that I have around me as real friends. I've told Brother Jeremy, I think that said that years ago. I said, brother, you ever see me get out of whack, you punch me square in the mouth, you get me right back in line. I don't care. I love the Lord. I want to serve him. And I know he'd love me. If he punched me in the mouth, I must have needed it. And I hope I have friends like that. I want to be amongst the people like that. And no matter what we would do, I would be amongst people that love you so much, they'd come after you. They'd say, no, I ain't going to let you go. No, love you too much. No, I'm not going to let you go that way. Don't you want to be a part of a people like that? That's the kind of people that I really admire being with. You may stand this evening. I hope that's okay. Kind of a Bible study tonight a little bit. It's a never-ending Bible study. Go look up divine love, and you begin to get very overwhelmed. The fact is, it's God. Explain God to me. Fully grasp the definition of this plan of God, because the whole thing is the mystery of love unveiled. And I just so happened by God's grace, and part of the mystery was that he was going to bring me into a presence that I could walk with him in that same kind of divine love. And God help me. Cut me, shape me, mold me, break me. It doesn't matter. Let me come into that. That's my hiding place. That's my rapture. Let's just have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you, Lord, for a message in this day that it came down, Lord, to reveal to us who we really are and what you really wanted out of a people, Father. Not like we've heard, maybe I grew up hearing that God just wanted to make you wealthy and bless you and give you gifts so you can do these things, mighty things. No, that wasn't what you were looking for. You were looking for a bride, someone that would love you so much that they'd serve you whether you blessed them or not. Someone that loved you so much, Father, that they would even be able to express that love to no matter to everyone around them. It was such a tangible love. Father, you looked for a certain kind of people. I believe we found them. Lord, I believe you've got a bride that just loves you so much because she recognizes what you did for her. That gives her this great love. Not that we loved you, but you that loved us, Father. Lord, it's a truly a great revelation for us that I pray, Lord, that you would just continue to rapture us up into that divine love. Just keep climbing higher, Father. Just keep lifting us higher and higher. Lord, just keep doing what you've already been doing. You've started this work in us. I believe you'll finish it, Father. Lord, forgive us for a condemning attitude if we've had one. Forgive us, Lord, for not wanting to bear with another brother or another sister. Forgive us for having a judgmental, critical attitude towards one another. May, Lord, we love a brother like we would want to be loved if we had done something wrong, Father. Lord, give us that kind of a nature and attitude, Lord, towards one another. No matter what they do to us, may we be able to express your divine love, that same love you expressed to us. Father, be with our pastor, be with Brother Joe and the services that are happening. May everyone be blessed. May they be anointed, Father, to speak your word. And may there be souls that would come in and find pardoning grace. Father, I just pray for Brother Emmanuel, Sister Mimi. Lord, may the greatest force on earth, divine love, continue to be expressed through our precious brother and his wife. Wherever they go, Lord, whatever they do, may the world around them recognize God must be on earth again because no one can love like this. Lord, may they say the same thing about us. May they say, surely this people, they must be from God because no one can love like this people. Father, we love you. We commit ourselves to you this night. I pray, Lord, for Brother Nathaniel coming this Sunday and praying for Brother Noel. Just take our brothers and move them out of the way and continue to speak to us. Lord, we sure love you. We commit this evening into your hands. I pray you'd watch over everyone as they go home. We love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. Brother, you got a song?
Lord, I want to love you than I ever have before. You're so easy to adore. Lord, I want to love you more. Oh, Lord, I want to love you
to love you more.
God bless you all as you travel home. Brother, I'll give it back to you.
Here is love, vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood, when the praise of life our ransom shed for us his precious blood. Who his love will not remember, who can cease to sing his praise, he will never be forgotten. Throughout heaven's eternal day, on the mount of crucifixion, fountains open deep and wide, through the floodgates of God's mercy flowed a vast and gracious tide. Grace and love like mighty rivers poured incessant from above, heaven's peace and perfect justice kissed a guilty world in love. Let me all thy love accept thee, love thee ever all my days. Let me see thy kingdom only, and my life be to thy praise. Thou alone shalt be my glory, nothing in the world I see. Thou hast cleansed and sanctified me, thou thyself hast set me free. In the truth thou dost direct me, by thy Spirit through thy word and thy grace, my need is meeting as I trust in thee, my Lord. Of thy fullness thou art pouring thy great love and power on me. Without measure, full and boundless, drawing out my heart to thee. Oh, here is love vast as the ocean, loving kindness as the flood, when the Prince of life our ransom shed for us his precious blood. Who is love will not remember, who can cease to sing his praise, he will never be forgotten. Throughout heaven
heaven's eternal day. Oh, who his love will not remember? Oh, who can cease to sing his praise? He will never be forgotten throughout heaven.
How rich and pure, how many